Welcome to worship. Today we mark two important occasions in the church calendar, Christ the King Sunday and Stir Up Sunday. And as we progress through our worship, we'll see how these two things are closely linked. And of course, you will recognise that I have my bowl and my wooden spoon in honour of Stir Up Sunday. But we begin with a call to worship the King, a call to worship him in song and from scripture. Psalm 145, from The Voice. I will lift my praise above everything to you, my God and my King. I will continually bless your name for ever and always. My praise will never cease. I will praise you every day. I will lift up your name for ever. The Eternal is great and deserves endless praise. His greatness knows no limit, recognises no boundary. No one can measure or comprehend his magnificence. One generation after another will celebrate your great works. They will pass on the story of your powerful acts to their children. Your majesty and glorious splendour have captivated me. I will meditate on your wonders, sing songs of your worth. We confess there is nothing greater than you, God, nothing mightier than your awesome works. I will tell of your greatness as long as I have breath. The news of your rich goodness is no secret. Your people love to recall it and sing songs of joy to celebrate your righteousness. The Eternal is gracious. He shows mercy to his people. For him, anger does not come easily, but faithful love does, and it is rich and abundant. But the Eternal's goodness is not exclusive. It is offered freely to all. His mercy extends to all his creation. All creation will stand in awe of you, O Eternal One. Thanks will pour from the mouths of every one of your creatures. Your holy people will bless you. They will not be silent. They will talk of the grandeur of your kingdom and celebrate the wonder of your power, until everyone on earth who has ears to hear knows your valiant acts and the splendour of your kingdom. Your kingdom will never end. Your rule will endure forever. Amen.
You are Lord of creation and Lord of my life, Lord of the land and the sea.
You were Lord of the heavens before there was time, and Lord of all, Lord, you will be.
We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord, Lord of all, Lord, you will be.
You are King of creation and King of my life, King of the land and the sea. You are King of the heavens before there was time, and King of all kings you will be.
We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. Lord of all, Lord, you will be. We bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. King of all kings you will be, King of all kings you will be.
In response to the sung, spoken, and written call to worship, we, along with all creation, proclaim God as King. We confess him as Lord. We bow down in worship, adoration, reverence, humility, and obedience to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. As the next song plays, think about what it means for you personally to bow down and confess him as Lord.
We bow down and confess that you are Lord in this place. We bow down and
We have just confessed him as Lord in this place. What is this place? In normal times, we would think about our place of worship, the church building, the Salvation Army Hall, the house of God. But in this place is even more than that, isn't it? It's near yet far. It's communal yet personal. It's the whole world. It's the community in which you live and work. It's your home from which you are probably worshipping right now. It's wherever you are at any given moment. It's every part of your living, thinking, working, loving. It's your head and your heart. Do we truly confess God as Lord in all of those places? Do we bow down before him and really allow him to reign and rule in this place? What does that really mean? What does that look like for each one of us, for each of our lives? Dear Lord Jesus, we bow down before you now in praise and adoration, in awe of who you are, in reverence to your authority, in humility before your throne, in honour of your kingship, and in acknowledgement of your rule over all the earth. Teach us what it means to be your subjects, to live under your authority and within your will. Lord, help us to understand what this means for us as individuals in relationship with you, and where we need to change, please bring that about by your Spirit. Lord, we pray that each day we would learn to bow down and confess you as Lord in this place, and so live as you teach and desire. We pray that we would become your loyal subjects, seeking your face, devoted to you, playing our part in your mission and your kingdom here on earth. Amen. Let us pray out our commitment to worshipping him alone and making him Lord in this place by sharing the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So on this Christ the King Sunday, we have worshipped the King in word, in song, and through our prayers. We have declared him as Lord of Lords and King of Kings, ruler over all creation. We have personally confessed him as Lord, King, ruler, sovereign over our lives. I pray that we will give the King the praise and the glory due, but that we will also live lives that reflect his rule and his sovereignty over us, in who we are, in what we do and how we do it, in what we say and how we say it. And we're going to come back to those thoughts a little later in our service. But for now, as we've already said, today is also Stir Up Sunday. It's the day on which those who are going to make their Christmas puddings get started. There they will be, getting out their favourite family traditional recipe. They will assemble the ingredients and they will put them in their bowls and they will then begin to stir them all together. The family will gather and each family member will take a turn at stirring and will make a wish as they stir. There are a couple of traditions which link this Christmas pudding day with the Christian faith. I wonder if you know them. I'm going to share them with you just now. The first is that the pudding should be stirred from east to west. Can you think why that might be? It's in honour of the Magi, the wise men, those who travelled from the east to visit baby Jesus at his birth, which of course we celebrate at Christmas. So for me, stirring east to west means doing that. The other tradition which links pudding day with the Christian faith is that the pudding should have 13 ingredients. Now, why is that, I hear you say? That's to represent Jesus and his 12 disciples. There are many other Christian themes that we can draw from the preparation of the pudding. Many ingredients are combined to make a pudding. That's just like the body of Christ, that is the church, which is made up of many members. That's you and me. Each ingredient added to the pudding is there for a reason and has a specific role to play. That might be to bind everything together, to give texture, to bring out certain flavours. That's just like each individual Christian in the church. Each one of us has a part to play in the mission of God, through our unique personalities, our gifts, our talents, our resources. The pudding is only whole, complete and deemed a success when all the ingredients have been added and blended together. And so the body of Christ is not whole or complete, and the mission of God will not be fulfilled unless all members participate and work together. The ingredients for the pudding have to be stirred up to be effective. They have to be stirred up to produce the final product. Just putting them in the bowl is not enough. There needs to be some action. And we as Christians, we need to be stirred up into action. Attending worship once a week is not enough. Sitting in a church building or a Salvation Army hall when we're able to, or sitting in front of our computers as many of us do just now, is not enough. We need to be stirred up. We need to be stirred up into action for God and by God, so that each and every day we are focused on becoming the people God has called us to be, getting on with the work and the witness to which he has commissioned each one of us. So you see, Stir Up Sunday isn't really about the pudding. It's about the heart, the mind, and the will of the Christian. You see, its origins are actually entirely in the Christian faith, from the Anglican tradition, in fact. The day is so called after the collect for the day from the Book of Common Prayer, and it reads like this: Stir up, we beseech thee, O Lord, the wills of thy faithful people, that they, plenteously bringing forth the fruit of good works, may of thee be plenteously rewarded. If you're a baker, if you're making your Christmas pudding today, then perhaps instead of making a wish as you stir, reflect on what we've just said about the ingredients and say that prayer. Ask God to stir you up so that you'll be ready, willing and able to play your part in the body of Christ, that is the church. That you'll be ready, willing and able to play your part in the mission of God, that is the calling of each one of us. Reflect on those thoughts and say that prayer, whether you're a baker or not, and join with me in asking God to stir us up for his kingdom's sake. Let's pray together. Stir up, we beseech thee, O Lord, the wills of thy faithful people, that they, plenteously bringing forth the fruit of good works, may of thee be plenteously rewarded. Father God, Christ the King, Spirit of holiness, stir us up, ignite in us a passion for you and your mission that will result in fruit for the kingdom, seen in our lives and in the lives of others. Amen.
The scripture reading is from Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5, verses 13 to 26, and taken from the New Living Translation. You have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. For the whole law can be summed up in this one command: love your neighbour as yourself. But if you are always biting and devouring one another, watch out. Beware of destroying one another. So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other, so you are not free to carry out your good intentions. But when you are directed by the Spirit, you are not under obligation to the law of Moses. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear: sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarrelling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Let us not become conceited or provoke one another or be jealous of one another. Amen.
Our next song speaks about the character of God, particularly his great love. It speaks of the transformation that occurs when we surrender fully to Jesus. It speaks of the power of his Holy Spirit to transform us, to make us holy as he is holy.
This is a wonderful song written by the late General John Gowans, which speaks theological truth to us today on this Christ the King Sunday and Stir Up Sunday. It's a song of doctrine and testimony, and so I hope and pray that you can sing it with me as your belief, as your experience, right now, today. Now, many of you sharing this service with us will know full well that I am no cook and that there is no way on this earth that I would even attempt to make a Christmas pudding. And to be honest, I don't even really like Christmas pudding. I only really eat it out of tradition. It's what you do on Christmas Day, isn't it? But for the purposes of today, I did Google Christmas pudding recipes and I found loads. Here's a list of some of the ones I found. Easy pudding. I'm not even going to attempt that. Citrus and spice. Light and fruity, chocolate and cherry, mix and match, lighter, Chocoholics Christmas pudding, that might be one I'd like, vegan. I even found Christmas pudding ice cream and Christmas pudding trifle. Most of the puddings I found would contain some of the following ingredients: dried fruit, candied peel, mixed spice, treacle, suet, sugar, breadcrumbs, and of course flour. These were the most common ingredients, with nearly all the recipes I looked at preferring sultanas and raisins as the dried fruit component. But I didn't find one definitive recipe, because there were no two that had exactly the same ingredients. There was always something added, something taken away, something substituted. This got me thinking about what's in the bowl. As the myriad recipes suggest, we will each have our different answers to that question, and I'm sure if we ask people who are making their own puddings today, their recipes would probably be vastly different. But as I said, the most common ingredients, other than the very basic of eggs and flour, were sultanas and raisins. And so perhaps it's the fruit in the bowl that is the defining ingredient that makes a traditional Christmas pudding a traditional Christmas pudding. And that then turned my mind to the spiritual concept of fruit. In Matthew chapter 7 and verse 20, Jesus said, "By their fruit you will know them." The fruit defines who is true, who is of God, and who is not. In John chapter 15 and verse 7, he also said to his disciples, "If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit." So fruit in our lives is a sign of who we are and whose we are. And the fruit only becomes visible and abundant when we live in tune with Christ. Now that leads me back to Christ being the King of our lives, of him reigning and ruling in us and over us, helping us to grow and develop, stirring us up, enabling us to bear fruit. Do you see the connections between Christ the King Sunday and Stir Up Sunday? In spiritual terms then, the fruit is the defining ingredient of a life transformed by Christ. The fruit is the visible attribute of a true Christian life, one where Jesus reigns supreme. So it should follow then that all who profess to be Christians should produce and display this fruit. Now we saw when we looked at our Christmas pudding recipes that the ingredients, including the fruit, seemed to be a little bit of a pick and mix list. Not so the recipe of a Christian life. Not so with our faith. Not so with the fruit that we produce and display. In our reading from Galatians 5, it was made very clear what should be in our life and what should be out. And you will note that what is in the recipe is fruit, not individual fruits, but one ninefold fruit, which binds together the characteristics of all who live and walk in the Spirit of Jesus Christ the King. So what is this fruit of the Spirit that Paul speaks of? What are the defining characteristics of a true Christian? In other words, what should be in the Christian's bowl? Well, first, there is love. These cherries represent love. Here they are. It's no mistake that love comes first in this list. It is the greatest of all the commands, to love God. And it is the second greatest too, love your neighbour as you love yourself. Paul wrote specifically about the characteristics of love in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. In verses 4 to 8 he wrote this, "Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonour others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres." This kind of love is unconditional in time, in place, in person. It seeks the highest good of all others, and we should do and say all things in love. As the first thing in our bowl, it will surely bind all the other characteristics of the fruit of the Spirit together, for it is the greatest of them all. Next, there is joy. I have the grapes of joy. Joy is more than happiness, you know. It's contentment, a feeling of blessedness. It comes when we know we are in right relationship with the Lord. Isaiah spoke of joy in the Lord. When we find our joy in him, when we rejoice in him, when we centre all our passions in and on him, then everything else will fall into place and we will approach life with a different attitude, God's attitude. Nehemiah, another prophet, he spoke of the joy of the Lord being our strength. His joy and finding our joy in him gives us all we need. And again, it changes our attitude to life and towards other people. Now there is peace. My apple of peace. Peace is another level of contentment. It's not necessarily quiet, and it's not necessarily an absence of difficulty, but it is a quality that we cultivate in order to play our own part in bringing unity between people and helping relationships to flourish between people. Jesus said, "Blessed are the peacemakers." And he, Paul, Peter, and the writer to the Hebrews all encouraged us to make every effort to do what leads to peace, to keep the unity that is peace, and to live in peace with everyone. Such is the importance of peace in the life of the Christian. We must make every effort. Now we have patience. My pair of patience. Sometimes this is referred to as suffering or, sometimes this is referred to as long suffering or forbearance. Paul also wrote about bearing with each other in love in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 2. There seems to be an understanding that it is sometimes hard to get along with everyone. But when love is first and central, as we've already said, and as Paul said to the Ephesians, we can learn to be patient with one another. We can learn to get along. Patience is being slow to speak, slow to act, slow to anger, slow to judge. Patience is practicing the pause so that when we do speak, when we do act, it comes from a place of love. Then there is kindness. Kindness. Have you heard people speaking about random acts of kindness? Well, the fruit of kindness is not random. There's nothing random about it because it is intentional. It's deliberate. It's a conscious act. It's a permanent act, a permanent state. It's a way of living and loving that goes the extra mile and that gives the shirt and a coat to the one in need, without judgment, without condemnation, and with no expectation of reward. Acting with kindness, acting in kindness, should be a way of life for the Christian. Goodness is our next fruit of the Spirit. There we are, goodness. In Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 9, Paul writes, "The fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness and truth." Goodness is about doing the right thing all of the time. Not just in public, not just when it's to our advantage, but in private too, and even when it might seem to be to our detriment. We're back to putting the highest good of others before our own good. That really is goodness. Now we come to faithfulness. Faithfulness. Are we loyal? Are we dependable? Are we full of trust? At all times, in all circumstances, in all dealings with all people? Or are we easily swayed? In our faith, in our resolve, in our Christian character, in our actions? We could look to Job for an example of wonderful faithfulness. He who remained faithful to God despite all that he suffered and all that he endured. And we should look to cultivate faithfulness to God, truly making him king, so that the faithfulness, our faithfulness, shines through our dealings with others. Our penultimate fruit of the Spirit is gentleness. There we have gentleness. This fruit is sometimes referred to as meekness or humility. It's the concept of thinking of others before yourself. I wonder, do you remember the old Sunday school chorus, J-O-Y, Jesus first, yourself last, and others in between? Get the order right and we will know the joy of the Lord, and we will spread the joy of the Lord through our gentleness and meekness. Jesus did say, blessed are the meek. And Paul, writing to the Ephesians, he said, let your gentleness be evident to all. Once again, no discrimination, no judgment, but behave with gentleness towards everyone. And you will be blessed. And you will be a blessing too. And finally, we have self-control. We have self-control. Or do we? Can we control ourselves, or do we fly off the handle? Self-control is about behaving well in all circumstances, towards all people. This is about showing all the attributes of the ninefold fruit of the Spirit, all of the time. And we can only do that when Jesus really is King, and we allow him to control us. So there we have it, the fruit of the Spirit, the nine characteristics of a life lived under the control, under the authority, under the reign of Jesus Christ the King. These nine characteristics will define us as Christ followers. They will define us as followers of Jesus Christ, as belonging to him. The nine characteristics which, when stirred up and bound together, make us fruitful in our own discipleship and in our worship, work and witness for the Lord. We cannot pick and mix. We cannot take away from this list or substitute one of the attributes we don't like for something we find easier to swallow. We need to cultivate all of the characteristics of the fruit by remaining in Christ. And we do that by inviting his Holy Spirit into our lives, the ultimate ingredient which transforms a sinful wretch into a holy saint. So what's in your bowl? Which fruit, what fruit, is displayed in your life? All of it? Some of it? None of it? As we've just said, it should be all of it if we're living under the kingship and the lordship of Jesus Christ. So if it's only some of it or none of it that you identify in your life, that is displayed in your life, then we need to look at our bowls. We need to look at our bowls and we need to add the Holy Spirit to transform or even displace that which shouldn't be there. We need to ask him to stir us up and make us whole. We need him to help us grow and mature so that the world will see the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of the living God, the fruit of Christ the King in us. When the Holy Spirit is in us, the fruit will be evident. The fruit of the Spirit defines us as Christians, nothing more, nothing less. This is Christ's fruit, his perfect fruit, Christ's characteristics visible in us. As his followers, it should be our aim to become more and more like him. And so it should be our prayer that the ninefold fruit of his Spirit would become more and more mature and therefore more and more visible in who we are, what we do and how we do it, what we say and how we say it. So I invite you to pray the prayer with me. Move, Holy Spirit, move in my life. Move, Holy Spirit, to make me like Christ.
Thank you.
with me in this prayer of commitment to Christ the King, a prayer of surrender to his lordship and authority, which will enable us to be his people, to fulfil his mission, and see his kingdom here on earth. Reign in me, sovereign Lord, reign in me. Captivate my heart, let your kingdom come. Establish there your throne, let your will be done. Reign in me, sovereign Lord, reign in me. Amen.
Our final song for this time of worship is one of praise and adoration. We crown him as Lord and King. We recognise his character and his works, and we bow before his throne and worship him.
This final benediction. Lord of all glory and of grace, Lord of all nations, worlds and space, Lord God o'er all eternity, reign thou, O reign thou over me. Amen.